Gentlemen, thank you for returning to your seat and welcome back to the 8th Southeast Asian Mathematical Society Universitas Gajah Mada International Conference on Mathematics and its Application 2019. Today is the last day of the international conference.
We send many thanks to all infinite support and enthusiastic participation.
And after having a break, now we may proceed with the next session. Plenary Lecture 15 by the Honorable Speaker, Dr. Wim T. Van Horsen from Delft University of Technology, Netherlands.
Without further ado, we would like to invite the moderator of the Plenary Lecture 15, Dr. Renat Lina Arianti from Universitas Gajah Mada to come to the stage. Please welcome. Good
morning, ladies and gentlemen. In the next session, we will have a talk delivered by Dr. Engineer Wim T. Van Rossen from the Department of Applied Mathematics, Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands. Let's introduce a little bit about him. His research interests include asymptotic perturbation theory for ordinary differential equation, partial differential equation and difference equation, dynamical system, linear and non-linear vibration of elastic structure. Some of his publications in 2018, there is three publications. Recently, in dynamic simulation of a multi-cable driven parallel suspension platform with select cables. I think it's a short description for him. And please, Dr. Van Horsen, to come to the stage. You have 40 minutes, including discussion. Please.
Working. Yeah, we should try. Okay. Welcome you all, and first of all, I would like to thank Fajar Kusumo for inviting me to this lecture and for the very nice place here in Yogyakarta and the nice evenings we also spent. Let me tell you something about me. I'm an associate professor and a deputy head of my department in Delft, the Netherlands. And first of all, I would like to tell you something about my university and how my department is related to actually the subject of this conference, mathematics and its applications. In particular, I would like to tell you also something about the applications. Well, this is the tall building that used to be our building, and within a few years we will move back to that building again. It's now renovated, or they are going to renovate it, and this is part of our campus. So to give you an idea what it looks like, and where I'm coming from, well, that's the Netherlands. Most of you know it's in Western Europe, and to see the scale in the Netherlands, it's all quite close to each other. Yeah, it's a very small country. If you look at distances, the width is about 250 kilometers, and the length, you might say, is 400 kilometers. And if you look at the capital of our country, it's Amsterdam. That's almost 55 kilometers away from Delft. And if you look carefully, then here we have Delft, here the big city, The Hague, Rotterdam, and Amsterdam, and here we have Leiden, Utrecht, and all the other cities where we have universities. So distances are very small compared to what we have here in Indonesia. These are typical things that you will see if you come to the Netherlands. A lot of water. Yeah. Almost a quarter of our country is below sea level. And still we are living there quite safe. Yeah, so don't worry if you come to the Netherlands. It's nice to walk through the dunes, and then on one side you can see the sea that is higher than the land on the other side of the dunes. Yeah, and what we now also have, and that's something you can see immediately, I'm quite tall, but most people in the Netherlands are quite tall. Yeah, you also saw that, Floske, she gave also this week a lecture, compared to the Indonesian woman, she's also tall. Yeah, and that's typically what you have in northern European countries, people are much taller than in the rest of the world. Well, then about the Netherlands, if you're coming in springtime, then you can see a lot of tulips. That's what we have over here. Yeah, that's typical for the Netherlands, and also the windmill. That's typical old windmills. Where I am living, in Delft, that is quite near to where we also have a lot of glass houses where we grow vegetables and flowers, primarily flowers nowadays. And these are the glass houses. Yep, they are warmed up by gas, and also that's close, quite close to the sea. Next slide. If you now come to Delft as a student or as a researcher, then you will see that the city has about 100,000 people living over there. And almost a quarter consists of bachelor students, master students, and PhD students. So it's really, it's an old city, but also we have lots and lots of students. And what you will see is a lot of channels, a lot of water. This is our old town hall on the Market Square, and our university is the oldest technical university in the Netherlands. There are three technical universities, one is in Eindhoven, the other one in Twente, and the oldest one is our city in Delft. And if you come to the Netherlands, the infrastructure is quite good. So it's easily to travel from the airport to Amsterdam, to The Hague, to Rotterdam, to Delft, to whatever city in the Netherlands you would like to go to. And that's indeed very pleasant. Well, having been talking about the history, let's have a look at the structure of our university. And that's important, because the structure of our university is such that if you're working in mathematics, you automatically will see a lot of cooperation with other faculties, with other departments. If you look, we have 16 bachelor programs and 33 master programs, and it's subdivided over 8 faculties. Well, these are the numbers, 22,000 students, almost 3,000 PhD students we have at the moment, and there is about 5,000 people working at the university, 3,000 scientific staff, 2,000 supporting staff. And these are the faculties. We have a faculty of mechanical engineering. We have a faculty of applied sciences, which includes chemistry and physics. We have civil engineering. And in civil engineering, primarily we work on how to construct dikes, how to maintain your water, to look at all kinds of flow. Also, traffic flow on roads is included over there. We have architecture. We have aerospace engineering. And in the past, and still, a lot of students from Indonesia are coming to Delft to do aerospace engineering. Yeah, that's. And here we have our electrical engineering, mathematics, and computer science, and additional design. And we also have the management department. If you look, for instance, at what I'm doing a lot of things on partial differential equations, ordinary differential equations. And if you do that, then there are lots of applications that are done in other faculties, like physics, like civil engineering like aerospace engineering. So I do a lot of projects which are motivated by research done in those faculties, and I have also a lot of cooperation with them because sometimes I supervise their students and vice versa. So we do a lot of common projects for our students, and that means that automatically you're getting involved in doing all kinds of applied things. So your PDE is not something abstract, but it becomes related to applications, and that's also the subject of this conference, mathematics and its applications. So what I'm going to tell you in the rest of the talk will be related to some of the applications we did. And primarily, it started that research with a common research with people from mechanical engineering, where they looked at vibrations in conveyor belts. And later on, that was extended to vibrations in elevator cables. That will be more or less what I'm going to tell you. And I will show you how mathematics can be applied to those problems, and how from those problems in the applied sciences, you can get interesting mathematical problems again, which can be studied and which are not seen yet by the mathematicians. Yeah, and that gives you then also a nice way to publish lots of papers in good journals, because you're doing something which is interesting for the people in applications, whereas it's also interesting for the people working in mathematics, because you get different types of problems, new boundary conditions that were never looked at, for instance. Okay, so let's have a look at actually what I'm going to tell you about mathematics. I'm going to tell you something about an elementary thing that most likely you've already seen in a course on partial differential equations. Yeah, the string equation, the wave equation. You're familiar with the method of separation of variables. You're familiar with characteristic coordinates. And what I'm going to show you is that the classical boundary conditions that you encountered, Dirichlet conditions, Neumann conditions, Robin conditions, that those can be extended to more complicated boundary conditions which have a physical application, and in this case in mechanical engineering, and that is actually not really considered by people in mathematics. But it gives you a way, again, to solve a lot of problems for those complicated things which need some mathematics to solve it. And I'm going to show you how to do that. And of course, if you're doing research, that's always in cooperation with others, and usually PhD students. So here I have a few PhD students with whom I did this work. Tuğçe Akaya, she's from Turkey. She defended her thesis last year, and she is now a lecturer in Twente University. Nick Gaiko is a student from Belarus, and he defended his thesis also 2 years ago, and he's now working at a big bank in the Netherlands, ABN AMRO. And Rajab Molukani, he is from Pakistan. He defended his thesis 3 years ago, and he's now back at his university in Pakistan. Yan Dong Wang was a PhD student from a mining university in China, and he visited me for 2 years because they were interested in the mathematical methods that we are doing, and his mining in university was very interested in how to tackle that problem also analytically. So he worked 2 years together with me, and then he defended his thesis in China under the supervision of Professor Zhao Cao. Okay. Okay. Overview of this lecture. After giving the introduction and the history of the problem, I'm going to look for wave equations on semi-infinite domains. And I will tell you about the classical boundary conditions. But also, I will tell you something about the non-classical boundary conditions, how you can treat them, and how you can do new research. And also, I will look at bounded intervals with non-classical boundary conditions, and then it turns out that for certain problems you cannot apply the method of separation of variables. But what can you do then? And then it will turn out that still we can do some elementary mathematics, yeah, which is interesting for people in research. And finally, I will draw some conclusions and will tell you something about future research, or research that we already started up with a lot of PhD students, also with students from Indonesia. Okay, you're all familiar with the wave equation. That's given here. Yeah, that's the famous wave equation. Constant coefficients, UTT minus UXX is zero on an infinite domain. If you give initial conditions, the initial displacement is F and the initial velocity is G, Then already in 1747, Jean-Laurent d'Alembert derived his famous formula. That's now, well, we teach that to almost all students, undergraduate students, and perhaps graduate students that follow a course on partial differential equations. They all know the formula of d'Alembert. And you can easily see that if you substitute t is equal to zero, then this is equal to f. And if you differentiate the series with respect to t and then take t is equal to zero, then you get back g. And you can also see that if you substitute this formula into the partial differential equation, then it nicely satisfies the problem. Yeah, so this is the solution of this problem. How can we use this problem to solve initial boundary value problems on initial on semi-infinite intervals or on bounded intervals subject to classical and non-classical boundary conditions? That is what I'm going to explain to you. And why are we considering these problems? Well, it turns out that in a lot of applications with more complicated boundary conditions, we still can use that formula, although it's not recognized by the mathematicians on one hand, and for the people in mechanical engineering, for instance, the problem looks too difficult, so they are not going to solve it in that mathematical way. And as a mathematician, you're just in between, and if you know something about that application and about something about the mathematics, then you can connect and then you can solve those problems. Okay. Well, the classical boundary conditions. So this is something we are telling our students in the second or third year in their bachelor. Yeah, at least in Delft we're doing that. And sometimes in the first year of their master. If you have a semi-infinite domain and you give a boundary condition at x is zero and you consider the problem for x positive, then of course f and g are defined for positive values of their argument, then I still can use the formula of d'Alembert. Because the formula of d'Alembert satisfies the PDE and satisfies the initial conditions. But it does not yet satisfy the boundary condition. But in the formula of d'Alembert, we now have a problem because f is not defined for negative arguments. And if you remember the formula, it's written here, then in that formula, we have here fx minus t. And if x, for instance, is 1 and t is too large, then you have here a negative argument. So you have to know f for negative arguments. Similarly, you have to know g for negative arguments. And if I look back, well, at the problem, then in the formula of d'Alembert, here only f and g are defined for positive arguments, because I have a semi-infinite domain. Well, if I substitute now my formula of d'Alembert into the boundary condition, it will turn out that that something that is not yet defined for negative arguments is going to be defined. And that's what you get. So if you substitute the formula of d'Alembert into your boundary condition, just substitute x is zero into your boundary condition, that should be zero according to this, then you get this expression. And then people in physics say, well, f and g need to be independent because it's an initial displacement and an initial velocity, and you can choose them independently. So this has to be satisfied and this. And that means that your function f should be extended as an odd function. So if f is odd, then the formula of d'Alembert can be used, and I nicely have the solution of my problem that is given over here. And that's what we teach our students. So if you have a Dirichlet boundary condition, then you get an odd extension. If you have a Neumann boundary condition, then you have an even extension. What's the case if you have a Robin condition? So if the force is proportional to the displacement, if you have this boundary condition? Well, it's not well known in the literature, but in 1891, that's a long time ago, more than 100 years ago, Brian introduced for a heat equation this transformation. And by means of this transformation, actually his problem for the wave equation is transformed into this problem with a Dirichlet condition. This problem we know how to solve because that's the problem I just solved for this with an odd extension. So this problem I can solve. So I can solve the problem for V. If I know V, then I can solve this equation because this is a first order PDE. And also a first order PDE can be solved by the method of characteristics. And that's also something we learn our second year or third year students in the bachelor. So if you know how to solve this problem, then you can solve this problem and you know your U. And that's what I explain here. Phi can be obtained, then you can solve for U. And if you look at the literature, it took us a long time to find something. This we found, and also the famous book of Tikhonov and Samarsky, 1964. You can find that problem, but that's typical a Russian book. So they give it as an exercise, and they only give you the answer. Yeah? And they don't tell you how to obtain it. Yeah? And afterwards, I could not find any book that was referring to this boundary condition. Yeah? So, but this is actually one way to tackle that problem. Interesting to see also how history and things get lost somehow. Yeah. Okay, then a non-classical boundary condition. And that's actually the problems that we are considering, because if you look at string equations, think of cables, think of whatever, people are putting, at the end, they put dampers. Why are they putting dampers to cables? Because they don't want to have oscillations. Yeah? In the Netherlands, we have a famous bridge, which is called the Erasmus Bridge. And just after its opening, it started to oscillate. Why? Because small rivulets of water were flowing on that cable. The cable became aerodynamically unstable and started to make vibrations. And that's something we did not like, because then also the bridge jack started to move a little bit. So the engineers placed dampers. First they measured the frequencies, and then they added dampers to that cable, or to those cables. The model for a damper is this. What does it consist of? A mass, a spring, and a dashpot. And if you apply Newton's second law to this mass, what forces are acting on that mass? That is the spring, the string, the cable, and here the damper. And if you write down Newton's second law, mass times acceleration is the sum of the external forces. This is the string force, this is the spring force, and this is the dashpot, the damper. So here, in a natural way, you have a boundary condition which is much more complicated than the boundary conditions of Dirichlet type, Neumann type, or Robin type. The question is, can we solve this problem? What we did was, again, well, use the formula of D'Alembert. If you use the formula of D'Alembert, then at least we satisfy the PDE, and we satisfy the initial conditions. We don't yet satisfy the boundary condition, because F is still, and G is only defined for positive arguments. So there is some freedom for the negative arguments, and with those negative arguments, that freedom, we can then try to satisfy the boundary condition. So let's do that. I substitute the formula of D'Alembert into my problem, and take x is equal to 0, and I get this. And then, if you again say that the initial displacement and initial velocity should be independent, I get an equation for F, and I get an equation for G. And now look at how complicated it is. F double prime t, t is positive, so this is a known function. F double prime minus t is an unknown function. F prime t I know, F prime minus t I don't know. Ft I know, F minus t I don't know. Ft I know, this I don't know. I gave this problem to several of my PhD students. I give more courses. And I also gave this once as an exercise in an exam for my students. Yeah? Because the students ask me, always add to the exam a difficult exercise for which only the very good students can find a solution. Well, at that exam, none of the students succeeded in finding the answer. Then, of course, the year after, the students are redoing their exams, and they then also see the old exam, and then I tell them how to do it. And then I placed a similar exercise in the exam, and then it turned out that the students could nicely solve that problem, because they know how to do it. So let's have a look how to do it. What you first should do is the following. Put the unknowns on one side, and put the known functions on the other side. So this is a known function, because it's a positive argument. F is defined for positive argument. So this is a known function. This is unknown, unknown, unknown. So I have derivatives of a function of f minus t. So let's make it a little bit more simple. Introduce the unknown function yt is f minus t. Then differentiate to get this. Yeah, differentiation. And then actually this equation is equivalent to this equation. And now all students recognize what they have. They have a second order ODE, within the right-hand side a known function of t, a second-order ODE with constant coefficient. They know all how to solve that because that's what you get in an elementary course on ODEs. And we wrote, together with a few of my PhD students, we wrote about two or three papers about this, and we published that in journals of Q1. Yeah, because it was new, not known, and actually it's extremely simple to do. Yeah, but still you can publish this in extremely good journals because it's something new. Yeah, and I know in Indonesia people are very looking for to do research and good research and published in good journals. Yeah, so this is research that you can do. It's really new. Yeah, but elementary. Yeah, well, elementary if you know the answer, I always say. Yeah, that's the way to do it. Okay. Then what we did also, because people are interested in how much energy is taken up by that boundary condition. So you can look at your parameters in your problem. You have your mass, you have your spring constant, and you have your dashpot constant. And then you can all do kinds of numerical computations with the solution. If you have a wave that is traveling initially to the boundary, then this is the reflected wave for different parameter values. Yeah, so if this is the wave traveling to the boundary, then these are a reflected wave for all different types of parameters. Then you can look at the energy, and you can look at the energy. It takes some time before the wave is coming to the boundary, and then energy is taken out. And then you can choose your parameters, and we do that here in different ways. Yeah, and here there is no dashpot, for instance, so then in this case there is no energy dissipation. And then you can see how much energy is taken out. Originally, we were interested in a conveyor belt with a damper on the boundary. So another PhD student of mine looked at that problem. And that is this problem, simply saying, this is the equation for a conveyor belt. That's a string. We don't only look at the vertical displacement, but that string is also moving in this way. Think of an elevator. Yeah, the escalator here, for instance. It's also actually a string that is going around. Yeah. And then you have oscillations perpendicular to that. That's described by you. This is the equation. And this is the boundary condition if you add a dashpot to it. Here you have your damper. Here you have a spring. And here this is actually due to the fact that it's connected to the string which is moving. Again, you can do the computations. And these are some pictures. This is a fixed end for a string that's moving in that direction. Here a free end, so it can move in that direction, and here you have a mass spring dashpot damper, and the string itself is moving in that direction. Yeah, so it's moving in actual direction, and we are looking at the displacement in this direction, and we are damping that. This is what you get if you have a semi-infinite string, and then this is almost the undamped case, and then you see something that is something that you should know something about physics. Because if you have a conveyor belt which is moving, then the boundaries are actually working on those endpoints. So energy is added or taken away only already by the movement. Yeah? So that depends on what the direction of your velocity is, your actual velocity, whether energy is in a natural way already added. And what you can do is by adding dampers, then you see what you can do. Yeah? You can really decrease the energy. So the red line is more or less already the energy that you always add, and this is the energy that you can take out by looking at, let's say, adding a damper. Yeah, here is your energy, here is time. Then a more complicated problem. Now let's have a look on a bounded domain. Yeah, because conveyor belts, elevator cables are always bounded. Yeah, bounded domains. And I give you here a problem which is equivalent to a problem. I'm not going to derive that. But it's equivalent to a problem with an elevator cable. Yeah, think of an elevator cable that's moving downward. Very simple. You all, as kids, played the very nice thing with a rope. And if you take a rope and you apply the correct frequency at the top, then at a certain moment you get heavy oscillations. Yeah, the frequency fits to the length, and then you get resonance. What you're having for an elevator cable is something similar. The top end might move. Yeah, if you think of a tall building, there's always wind, so the building moves a little bit. Or the cable is rolling off of the drum. Yeah, then also you have a natural excitation at the top. And at a certain moment, the length fits to that frequency and you get resonance. And then the question is, how long does that cable stay in that resonance zone? Well, you can formulate that problem, you can do a lot of complicated transformations, but finally you will end up with a problem for a wave equation with initial conditions, boundary conditions on this side, and a boundary condition on this side. The interesting thing is that due to the length variation, you don't have a constant here, but you have a function of time. And now the question is, I cannot do the method of separation of variables. That's what we teach all our students in the second year or the third year. Separation of variables, that's the way to solve a boundary value problem. But since we have a time-dependent boundary here in the coefficient, you cannot do separation of variables. How can we solve this problem? Of course, a lot of people will say, okay, then we're going to use a numerical method. But a numerical method has a drawback because then you have to give all your coefficients. Whereas here you can do a parameter study. How can we solve this? Well, let's have a look. Again, use the formula of D'Alembert. You get this for the one boundary condition, and for the other boundary condition, you will get this. This already we know. This is the odd extension. So due to the boundary condition that we have here, this will give us an odd extension. So with respect to x is 0, we should extend it as odd. Now also note that our problem is only defined on the interval 0, 1. So this gives an odd extension with respect to x is 0. The question is, how should we expand the functions with respect to x is 1? How to expand it with respect to x is 1? I should stay a little bit nearer, I think. Yeah. How should we extend it with respect to x is 1? Substitute the formula into the formula of D'Alembert, you get this. And then again say, well, it should be valid for all f and g, so independent. And then we get our differential equation for f, for instance. That's this one. Again, here we have a known function. This is an unknown function. And this is even the most simple, one of the most simple first order ODEs that you have to solve. So on the interval 1, 2, you have to solve a first order ODE. Well, you can do that. So you know the extension with respect to that boundary condition. And then you can repeat the procedure. You have to do the odd extension with respect to x is 0. And then you can extend your function to the interval minus 2, 0. Then again, with respect to x is 1, yeah, you solve this. And then you can repeat the whole procedure. And this is what I did with one of the Chinese students from the mining university who was interested in the oscillations of those mining cables. So here you see the extensions, and after a period of 2, then actually you have back the same problem. Yeah? And so you can repeat it and repeat it. And we did a lot of numerical computations on that. Yeah. Conclusions. It turns out that the formula of D'Alembert can be used to a much larger class of problems than we originally assumed. So for non-classical boundary conditions, you can also use it. How are we going to extend this? Well, actually, we are also interested in beam equations. Yeah, so if you have bending stiffness in your cables, then you get a fourth order PDE, and we would like to extend it as well to those type of problems. But the formula of D'Alembert for that problem is not that simple. Yeah, it contains very nasty functions. Yeah, but still, we are trying to do that. In reality, of course, you also have also a lot of nonlinearities in your problem. Yep. Cables are not linear if the displacement becomes too large. So you get small nonlinearities in your problem. And then you would like to apply a perturbation method to solve the problem. To solve the problem with perturbation methods, actually you have to know how you solve non-homogeneous problems. And that's also something we are doing at the moment with some of my PhD students. One of them is coming from China and we are working this out. Future research. Well, I wrote down here a lot of projects that at the moment I'm doing. Yeah, with students from Indonesia, from China, with some of my master students, only to show you how I connect to people with from other faculties within our university. The first problem is about transverse and longitudinal vibrations in actually moving continua. Think of elevator cables, think of conveyor belts. Originally, I started with conveyor belts, and that was a joint project with people from mechanical engineering, where they had a difficult PDE, and they tried to solve nonlinear problems, and they did not do exactly how to do that. I started that project, and one of the first PhD students that worked on that project was Kade Suwaken from Bali, and he defended his thesis in 2003. Still, we are working on this problem. Yeah, I had a student from Russia, Svetlana Ponomareva. She defended her thesis on that. Rajab Malokani from Pakistan worked on that problem. And they all wrote papers in the important journals. Yeah, and most of them wrote three or more journal papers. Yeah, but it's on the verge of mathematics, one hand, and applications on the other hand. Yeah, and in that region, a lot of interesting work still can be done. Then, if you are applying dampers to all kinds of structures, then sometimes you have a feedback in your system. So that means that you get delays in your equation. So then I would like to have a good perturbation method, a multiple timescale method, for those type of problems. I started that project already, that's the second project. I started that project already up with a master's student, but I will continue that with a student from Indonesia, Niki Nashi. She will work on that problem the coming years. Then a perturbation problem for moving boundary problems. And that is actually a problem where you have cables that are moving over an obstacle. So then the effective length of that cable is changing in time. It's a classical problem because if you think of the ice-water problem, where you heat up the water, then the interface between water and ice is moving in time. And that's the classical Stefan problem. And also for that problem, only a few exact solutions are known, but it is not known how to obtain, with a perturbation method, solutions for that problem other than the static solutions. So we are interested in the dynamic solutions. So we are extending our perturbation methods, and that's something at the moment what I'm doing with Aditya from Bandung, and he's a PhD student under the supervision of Teotihuacan Kota and me, and we have a joint project where that student is doing for 9 months research in Indonesia and is coming for 3 months to my institute, and then we do the research and he finally will defend his thesis here in Bandung. Yeah, but that's how we set up all kinds of problems. Then the problem of the actuated beam, and that's actually an interaction that I have with people from my physics department and from mechanical engineering, where they look at micro beams, yeah, MEMS and NENS, yeah, nano electrical mechanical systems. Yeah, and they would like to make all kinds of sensors on the micro scale. On the micro scale, you get the same type of equations. Beam equations, wave equations, membrane equations. And to solve them, you get interesting nonlinearities. Not the nonlinearities that we already know of polynomial type, but the nonlinearities are due to the potential difference between those plates. It's of 1 over a polynomial. And that gives you, again, a new way to tackle a lot of interesting mathematical problems, unknown. At the moment, I'm working with that with a colleague from Bandung and with people from the mechanical engineering and from the physics department. Reflections of waves due to nonlinear boundary conditions. Well, you already saw that we were interested in reflections of waves. That's what I explained here. But usually, people attach to all kinds of structures what is called a nonlinear attachment. And with those nonlinear attachments, they try to get energy out of the system to damp the oscillations. So actually, the things are nonlinear. So we are interested also in nonlinear boundary conditions and how to tackle those problems. That's also a problem that we are doing. With a colleague from Aachen, we are doing a problem on how to reduce systems of PDEs, knowing the physics of the problem, and put that into the system to obtain less PDEs that still are describing the correct dynamics of our problem. And another one is bifurcation analysis in reaction diffusion problems. That's a problem that I'm doing with a colleague from China, but also here with Fajar Kusumo and his student Fitriana. We are starting that up, and we are interested in a bifurcation analysis in reaction diffusion equations, with a guy from China, it has another application than here. Here it's more in the tissues, the cancer tissue and the spreading and things like that. But that's how we try to build it up, and also to set up an asymptotic theory which validates the results that we are obtaining. And also Lina is there also involved in that project. Okay, then the last thing is bifurcation of periodic and quasi-periodic solution in nonlinear resonator problems. That has to do also with, you perhaps know graphene. Graphene is a one layer thick, very strong material made of carbon, and that has a lot of interesting unknown properties. And people in mechanical engineering and physics try to get to know the properties of that material, so they do a lot of experiments. So they have those layers, and then they have laser, and then they excite those things, and then they measure, do a lot of measurements. They would like to know, for instance, what is the what they call the quality factor, that's more or less the damping, because those nano materials will be used in all kinds of sensors in the future. And then you have to know the properties of those materials. And what we are doing is we are making models. With that models we can analyze that mathematically, and then we can predict what the damping parameter is, and then the measurements will say, okay, then for this material, this is your damping factor. And this is just an example. These are just examples with all kinds of projects that I'm doing. But I have a lot of colleagues in my institute on applied mathematics, and most of them are doing the same thing with people from other departments. And at our university, my colleagues also have a lot of publications, yeah, in good journals. Why? Because they have a lot of cooperation. They get new, interesting mathematical problems with a lot of interesting physical problems. And that's also what we have in this conference, mathematics and its applications. And it's a very, very nice field. And here at Gadamer University, you also have lots of opportunities to cooperate with people from other departments. Yeah, you also have here an engineering department that is doing a lot on vibrations. Yeah, but there are many, many more possibilities. And as mathematicians, you should try to use it, because you get a lot of new and interesting mathematics. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you for a nice presentation. This time we have a few minutes. Is there any question, comment, or suggestion from the floor? Is there any question?
Yeah, here's a question. Yeah.
Yeah, please mention your name and institution, please.
If an extension in the wave equation for semi-infinite domain, the first one.
Infinite domain.
Semi-infinite domain. Is it possible to use even extension for the function?
Yeah. I try to show you that we start with the infinite domain, then you look at the semi-infinite domain, and the last example was an example where I had a bounded domain. So then you get a reflection with one boundary condition and the other one, and then you continue. So if you, that's also what we, well, you can tell that also to the students in the second and third year, where you have, for instance, two Dirichlet conditions, so u is zero on the boundary, on the bounded interval, so this side, and then with respect to each side, it should be extended as odd. So then you get a periodic extension, but for these problems, you usually don't get a periodic extension, so it depends on how far you're going, but then you can extend it in principle to the infinite domain. And that's what I did with one of the students, Yan Dong Wang. For instance, yeah.
And the second one, in the classical wave equation, we have that the velocity is the velocity is constant, and it doesn't depend on time. I call it for non-autonomous with equation, it means that C is function of T, so CT. Is it an interesting topic?
Yeah, that's a very nice and interesting question, because that's also the problem we encountered in the problem that I showed you with Yandong Wang. This problem, if you have an elevator cable that's moving downward, and then you get time-dependent coefficients in your PDE, and you get time-dependent coefficients in your boundary condition. And here we have a time-dependent coefficient in your boundary condition. But you can apply a time transformation for that problem, which is related to the WKBJ method, the Rylov, Krylov, Bukolyakov, Jeffries method. You can apply time transformation for that particular problem, and then you will get a constant here, and here a time-dependent coefficient, and of course here you will get, instead of zero, you will get small terms. And that's the reason why I told you I would like to apply perturbation methods, and we are actually applying perturbation methods, and that's how we tackle that problem with a time-dependent coefficient in your wave speed. Yeah, so that's, for this problem we could do that, but in general that will be a difficult problem if you cannot have a real physical reason to do the time transformation. Yeah, but in this problem we did that also. Good question. Thank you. Yeah, because if you're going to do the perturbation theory, then you get modal interactions. Yeah, you look at oscillation modes, and then you get the dynamics of the problem given by how the modes are interacting, so the oscillation modes. The restricted three-body problem. I did a lot of things with that with students from aerospace engineering. But of course you get your nonlinear oscillators. And the three body problem, of course, is also a coupled system of nonlinear oscillators. Yeah, but I think it's not here, the real nonlinearities are not the three body problem, but are other types of nonlinearities. By what? I don't know. But the principle is always that you get infinite dimensional system of for your oscillations, and then there are some invariants, and then you can usually reduce it to a finite number of ODEs that are coupled. So in that sense it resembles the three body problem, but that problem is hard because you only have a few first integrals for that. Yeah, and then you have to apply other methods to yeah, actually, I know from a lot of students from aerospace engineering that they are planning missions for satellites, and then they have to go around certain planets a few times, and then they look at stability of those orbits, and that's usually what they do. Yeah, but that's also a lot of numerics is involved. Yeah, and that's something I try to avoid, numerics. That's the. Yeah, does it answer your question? Partly. Okay.
Okay, because of the time, I think it's, please come to the stage.
I come to the stage, yes.
In my opinion, you said that this is a simple problem, but for me, especially, this is not simple. Actually, from the idea how to transform, to handle the boundary, the complicated boundary by the Arnold formula, this is not simple for us. thank you for the nice question and nice presentation. And I think we should give Dr. Wim van Horsen applause for him. Thank you. Okay. I give it back to the Master Sarim.
Thank you very much to our moderator, Dr. Renat Lina Arianti, for the driving the great discussion between the honorable speaker and all the participants.
To Dr. Wim T. Van Horsen and Dr. Renat Lina Ariati, please stay on the stage. Now I would like to invite Professor Christiana Rini Indrati as the steering committee of the 8th SIMS UGM 2019 to come to the stage and pass on the souvenir and the certificate to our honorable speaker and the moderator.